minimum is just red. And also that. No, I'm not talking just stagnant. I don't know. Yeah. And I actually had a good sense to stop at Walgreens on my way to meet you this morning. I mean, no, but like, I recognize something. And I was going to live in Belgium, so I didn't.
How do you extend it out?
Oh, you know, it was embarrassing because that is the working world. You know, it's been better through. That's how it's always going. Huh? I've tried. Zyrtec, no more Viagra. No, I don't want
Allegra.
I also take Benadryl.
Thank you.
there is a creature if anyone wants it. You want to pull this out as well? Sure, right? But, okay. No, I was going to thank you for doing that. Should I do that? I'm going to do that now, actually. I'm going to do it now. I'm going to thank you.
Sure, Sharon. Sure.
I got my arm.
Keynote speaker we could have for this conference, this symposium. I just wanted to thank my co-organizers who've been absolutely amazing to work with and who have really done an amazing job. Jovan, please stand up. Jovan and Kylie with Kylie. Kirby, stand up. Camilla and Kylie, are we going to have to clap for them in absentia? Let's clap for them. And also Kenley, let's get Kenley here. And thanks to everyone for all the, you know, someone called it a labor of love, and Jordana called it a labor of love, and it really, Camilla, thank you. Camilla is the real trailblazer. In the kind of revival of, let's say, of Berkeley Black geography. So Camilla, we're really in your, you know, following in your footsteps. And Kelly, we've already clapped for you in your absence. And Kenley is somewhere. Okay, well, thanks to everyone for all the energy you brought to the last 2 days. It's just, and we're not going to let you off the hook that easily. We're going to keep going. We're going to do other things. We're going to continue the project in all sorts of ways. We'll start talking about it tomorrow. It's a great honor to introduce, again, as I said, the only keynote speaker we could have. Almost everyone in speaking over the last 2 days has invoked Catherine Kittrick. Willie put it beautifully in the last session that Catherine has given people the license, black intellectuals in geography, the license to speak and to recreate this new and I hope increasingly central field in reimagining geography, you know, and the disciplines. I mean, let's think big. The world, tomorrow the world. Catherine's my comrade in the Antipode editorial, well, recent ex-comrade in the Antipode editorial collective. She doesn't know it yet, but the Antipode, there's a retirement home for former editors, so we're going to be comrades in the retirement home. So Catherine McKittrick, professor of gender studies at Queen's, well known for bringing a variety of threads together, black literary and cultural studies, black feminist critique, obviously, STS, science and technology studies, Afrofuturism, Caribbean thought, black diaspora studies, anti-colonial, decolonial, post-colonial thought, incredibly capacious thinker. And her work, several of her books have become foundational texts. Demonic Grounds, Black Women and Cartographies of Struggle. The 2007 collection, Black Geographies and Politics of Place with Clyde Woods, all this work is in the wake of these texts. Also, the more recent book with Sylvia Winter, Sylvia Winter on Being Human as Praxis, and Catherine is also, she's really models a kind of way of being in the academy, which is of inclusion and of engagement, and the work with Sylvia Winter, I think, represents this, and the work in Black Geographies represents this. She's a community builder, you know, and that's why she's the perfect person to have here. Several important articles, Plantation Futures, Mathematics of Black Life, and if I think of there's several things that are important to her work and which she's important for, but one really important thing to me from my perspective is dogged refusal of any kind of repetition of black, anti-blackness in various covert forms. And that kind of, that has taken her into the themes of our symposium, the quest for archival and representational creativity in order to rethink forms of freedom and to rethink the many iterations of the Black Freedom Movement. That's all I'm going to say. Her talk is called Footnotes, Books, and Papers Scattered About the Floor. Thank you very much, Catherine. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. I have a few remarks to make before I start my talk. I want to thank Jovan, Sharad, Camilla, Kaylee, Kirby, Kendi, and Jane. I also want to thank Lisa and Sharita for those bags, of which was one of my two tweets, which is very limited for me from this conference. I've been holding back. But got lots of likes and retweets, so thank you for that, and a few followers, because that's what matters. thank you all for all of your hard work and your labor. And I know I've done a few of these, and as was mentioned before, they're difficult to pull off, and it's long and it's tiring. So I thank everyone for also being here. In this warm room, explain the environment outside, devastating man-made ecocide. I also want to thank the panelists and chairs for their welcoming and generous read of that old book, which I think has lots of limits, but is also giving life, as you mentioned, and I appreciate that, and it brings tears to my eyes to hear that, so thank you. So, the discipline of geography is difficult. At my university, I've been on the committee of a black geographer and an Asian geographer for 4 to 5 years. I've been asked to leave their committee because I'm considered a wild card. I'm also not permitted to supervise in that department. I can only co-supervise under with an overseer. The overseer has to be a real geographer. There are two white men who also are cross-appointed, as I am. They also aren't permitted to supervise. But it plays out differently. I don't think I have to explain that to you. So, I'm being positioned within the discipline of geography in my home institution as unqualified, undisciplined, and wild. And I also want to sort of point to the impossibility of blackness within the discipline of geography and how we must think generously as we sit here at Berkeley. And Carolyn Finney isn't here. And I think that's really important for us to notice and think about the impossibility of blackness within the discipline of geography. And we can also tell a similar kind of story around Ruth Wilson Gilmore. So I just want to sort of honor those women specifically who have inspired my work, who are, you know, do fantastic work, but think about that in relation to the unqualified, undisciplined, wild black woman that is produced within the discipline of geography and other disciplines as well. Geography isn't the only discipline that disciplines us. So, but we are at a Black Geographies conference, so I'll point the finger a little. And my last remark is to sort of think about the work of Clyde Woods. My second tweet was to LaToya saying that I cried with her talk, and it was because I miss him. I miss him a lot. I miss Richard Eiten a lot. I think that this is in the spirit of the work of Clyde Woods as well. So I thank everybody for sort of bringing that having conversations about his work and really honoring his memory in a really, really meaningful way for me. I'll stop there, otherwise I'll cry. In terms of the talk I'm going to give today, it's part of my new book called Dear Science and Other Stories, and I'm thinking about storytelling in relation to Sylvia Winter's work on storytelling, but also my dear friend Dina Georgis' work on storytelling as well. So that's sort of my theoretical context, but I also have my footnotes on the right are scrolling up, and then some books that have inspired me on the left. So that's, I'm also talking about these images. Okay. And this is my first time giving this talk, so I'm terrified. In about 2015, I began scrolling images at my public talks. The image slides are on a continuous loop. The image slides are of ideas in text, song, visual art, maps and places, objects, people that have shaped my thinking. I started doing this because I was finding it difficult to track within the context of a public talk how I know what I know, where I know from, who I know from, and what I cannot possibly know. I try to make a new slideshow or film for each public talk. I'll have a caveat there that my student Kim Tran did this for me because I was like, so I thank her as well. I tried to make a new slideshow or film for each public talk, so I remember to visit ideas before I give a presentation and to think about them in a new context. I include these images because while I know my research fields intimately, I feel like how I came to know these fields is fading. So I revisit and recontextualize. At the same time, this history, my memory, is overlaid by newer research questions, texts, images, events, and places. Confidently in my own specific and scattered way, to give an obvious example, I know well the tensions between modernity, race, gender, and blackness. I found my way to this confidence by reading and rereading scholars who have studied race, capitalism, and modernity. I found my way by sharing and talking and writing about writers and scholars and cultural producers I love to teach, read, reread, and read again. I found my way by rereading and reading work I do not agree with, and by making my way through books and ideas that I dislike. I sometimes show texts such as images of music, so scores, album covers, art, or album cover art, musicians, because I adore music, and it structures my life and work, but these ideas are not represented satisfactorily in my research. The non-words of sounds, as Al-Tawhilia says. I show the images because I've increasingly noticed that some labor, specifically the exertion that lies within studying and writing and making and grooving, somehow seems to disappear after issuance. The exertion disappears. The images are on a loop, and I add to this loop frequently. The images are not intended to carry clear meaning. They are looped, and the loop represents what I and what we cannot say or hear or see or remember, just as it establishes a repetitive, circular, and also inaccurate representation of coming to know. The loop is not intended to be meaning-making, but instead shows fragments and moments of knowing. Shadows, the interstices of the invisible and visible, residual elements may be articulated by and within new social practices, in effect as a new emergent formation. I show the images because I want to be as honest as I can about my intellectual history, while also recognizing my dishonest memory. I show the images because I want to be honest about where my ideas come from, while recognizing that this is also a process of forgetting. My sadness sits around me, June Jordan. And so I read in and with Black Studies to honor those who have shared their intellectual and political energy with me, their effort in myriad infrastructures, feelings, texts, stories, exchanges. So this short story is about citations, endnotes, footnotes, references, bibliographies, texts, narratives, parentheses, sources, and pages. To riff on Trevor Ellison and Ronald Morrison, I'm going to talk about working off the page. It is a story, one of many, about what we do with books and ideas. It is a story about how we arrange and effectuate ideas that make ideas. By observing how arranging and rearranging and collecting ideas outside ourselves are processes that make our ideas our own, I think about how our ideas are bound up in ideas that we do not or should not claim we own. This leads me to work through the ways Black studies and academic research and writing, when we are doing our very, very best work, acknowledges the shared and collaborative intellectual praxis that makes our research what it is. This is for me especially important because our ideas on the page and in the presentation might suggest otherwise. Sometimes our ideas imply that we arrived there in that page or presentation on our own as the sole owners of our own ideas, a property of interest, risking the sovereignty of our own stories. What if the practice of referencing, sourcing, and crediting is always bursting with intellectual life that takes us outside ourselves? What if we read outside of ourselves, not for ourselves, but to actively unknow ourselves, to unhinge, and thus come to know each other intellectually, inside and outside the academy, as collaborators of collective and generous and capacious stories. Unknowing ourselves. The unhinging opens up a different conversation about why we do what we do here in this place that despises us. Not focusing on reparation of the self alone, but instead sharing information and stories and resources to build the capacity for social change. Alternative outcomes. Ruthie Gilmore. The unhinging, unknowing ourselves opens up learning processes that are uninterested in a self that is economized by citations. And still, displacing the self, unknowing who we are, is awful. It is indeterminate and unpredictable and lonely. Of course, togetherness can be difficult and lonely too. The awfulness, though, opens up a conversation about why we do what we do and offers a praxis for living here in this place that despises us. The unknowing brings together unexpected intellectual conversations that together resist dehumanization. The unknowing risks reading what we cannot bear and what we love too much. Unknowing ourselves. Unknowing does not seek to provide answers. The steady focus is instead upon working out how to share ideas relationally. Perhaps the function of communication, referencing, citation, is not to master knowing and centralize our knowingness, but to share how we know, and share how we come to know imperfect and sometimes unintelligible, but always hopeful and practical ways to live this world as Black. The text passes from a dream of transparency to the opacity produced in words. The parentheses enfold and convey, the notes buttress, and they leave shadows. Citing is not easy. Referencing is hard. So this is a story, one of many, about how we know and how we come to knowing and how we share what we know. I'm interested in how references, citations, and bibliographies are central to the project of Black Studies. I'm interested in ideas and learning and knowing. I believe that bibliographies and endnotes and references and sources are alternative stories that can, in the most generous sense, centralize the practice of sharing ideas about liberation and resistance and writing against racial and sexual violence. Alternative outcomes. I'm indebted to the endnotes and footnotes prepared by the motley crew of Richard Eitan, Lisa Lowe, Sylvia Winter, Vladimir Nabokov, and David Foster Wallace. The notes these authors include in their works not only show the demanding labor and effort that underpins research and writing, these notes signal stories of other stories that direct you to a story and a place connected to but not of the story you began, Pale Fire. This is not explicitly a story about the metrics of citation practices or impact factors. I am, as I'll note briefly below, cognizant of this important critique of white and patriarchal citation practices and how they can justify ongoing forms of domination. I'm more interested in how referencing works in Black studies and how this referencing uncovers a lesson that cannot be contained within the main text. What if citations offer advice? What if citations are suggestions for living differently? What if some citations counsel how to refuse what they think we are? Sarah Ahmed makes the meaningful observation that citation practices are deeply racialized. This is a political project for Ahmed because she argues absenting white men reorganizes our knowledge worlds. By excluding white men for her or our bibliographies, she or we can generate new ideas and chip away at and possibly break down the walls of patriarchy that have excluded and refused feminist ways of knowing. Decentering the citations, and thus the experiences of white men, unmakes a scholarly system that champions and normalizes white patriarchal scholarly traditions. I struggle with the outcome of this citation project, which unfolds outside of, but is not delinked from, Ahmed's observations. Here I recall mostly white, but always non-black in my experience, mostly white feminists sparklingly shouting with a kind of breathy desperation that they too have been oversighting and venerating white male scholarship, and that Ahmed has discovered a brand new way to recognize and credit and legitimize the ideas of the marginalized. This leads to these breathy speakers hailing the work of mostly non-black, mostly white feminist, mostly academic privileged scholars. That aside, Ahmed's citation project matters to me because it asks that we think about the epistemological grounds through which we theorize and imagine and name liberation in our referencing practices. Citation points to method and how we come to write what we know. Citation is important because it frames and supports and legitimizes our argument. This also shows, if we begin with Michel Foucault as our primary methodological theoretical frame, if Foucault is our referential scaffolding, we will most certainly draw Foucauldian conclusions. There's nothing at all wrong with a Foucauldian project and Foucauldian conclusions, of course. To suggest so would skirt around the work of citations I'm seeking to address. This example simply centralizes the importance of how referential beginnings shape conclusions. Theory is absence, obscure, and proipitus. That's Glissant. So working with Sylvie Winter, Glissant, and Frantz Fanon, I read and reread their work to observe their unframed and undisciplined analytical methodological worlds. These scholars, it seems to me, are much more interested in how we know and how we come to know than who we know. They tell us there is no beginning through which firm conclusions are made. They tell us beginnings to ends and questions with knowable answers are ineffective analytical equations. They tell us that liberation cannot in any way be a formulated answer to how we resolve the troubling, awful world we inhabit if it is posed as a subsequent counter-reaction to that awful, troubling world. For that end answer all too often demands a beginning question framed within the parameters of and thus invested in the systemic replication of our awful world. Anxiety to convey meaning often results in overemphasis, and emphasis as a way of conveying meaning means that you are unconsciously holding onto meaning and limiting it. Nervezi Philip. Sylvia Winter taught me to recognize how radical theory making takes place outside of existing systems of knowledge. Sylvia Winter taught me that radical theory making takes place outside existing systems of knowledge. Sylvia Winter taught me that radical theory making takes place outside existing systems of knowledge, and that this place outside demonic grounds is inhabited by those who are brilliantly and intimately aware of existing systems of knowledge. Sylvia Winter taught me that radical theory making takes place outside existing systems of knowledge, and that this place outside demonic grounds is inhabited by those who are brilliantly and intimately aware of existing systems of knowledge as self-replicating. Sylvia Winter taught me that radical theory making takes place outside existing systems of knowledge, and that this place outside demonic grounds is inhabited by those who are brilliantly and intimately aware of and connected to existing systems of knowledge as self-replicating, and that this awareness provides theoretical insights and projections of humanity that imagine a totally new way of being. One more. Sylvia, this is how you write a Winter sentence. Sylvia Winter taught me that radical theory making takes place outside existing systems of knowledge, and that this place outside demonic grounds is inhabited by those who are brilliantly and intimately aware of and connected to existing systems of knowledge, and that this awareness provides theoretical insights and projections of humanity that imagine a totally new way of being that observes how our present mode of being functions unjustly and cannot sustain itself ethically. Sylvia Winter taught me that black women are radical theory makers and that black women live demonic grounds. What Sylvia Winter, Frantz Fanon, and Edward Glissant and many others have taught me is to think about how sharing ideas enables a terrain of struggle through which different futures are imagined. In this instance, we must ask how the work cited of many Black scholars enable new humanism, radical theories of liberation, poetics of relation, a new worldview, and therefore refuse crude capital economization of collated names standing in as ideas. I'm not interested in citation as a way to include or exclude. I'm not interested in the critique of citations as empty repetition. I believe these are deeply meaningful projects, but I want to reference other possibilities. Citations as learning, as counsel, as sharing. I say this because after many years of thinking about referencing practices, I'm pretty sure much of the work of Black Studies does not cite books and articles and ideas and music and art in order to quickly and uncritically authorize the author's project. Mm-hmm. Much of Black Studies is not written for the impact factor. Mm-hmm. I think instead that referencing in Black Studies is a lesson in living. Mm-hmm. Put another way, I believe referencing and citation in Black Studies to be what Carmen Kennard calls vernacular insurrections. Narratives that are not only counter-hegemonic, but also affirmative of new, constantly mutating languages, identities, political methodologies, and social understandings that communities form in and of themselves, both inwardly and outwardly. Not merely the bits and pieces chipped off or chipping away at dominant culture, but a whole new emergence. That's a quote from her, that whole quote. The notes and citations the books, the references have, to borrow again from Kennard, Black freedom-inspired purpose. So I suggest that Ahmed, to get back on track in some ways and derail ourselves, hopefully, I suggest that Ahmed incompletely continues the work of many Black feminists and Black scholars. Black thinkers have always turned to each other to generate ideas and develop a body of scholarship that calls out and responds to the overarching biocentric colonial knowledge system that cannot in any way honor Black intellectual life. Mm-hmm. Ida B. Wells, Red Record. Mm-hmm. Turning to each other is not, though, an inward-looking, ethnically absolutist project. The intellectual and cultural achievements of the Black Atlantic populations exist partly inside and not always against the grand narrative of enlightenment and its operational principles, Gilroy. This scholarship delineates worldviews outside and across white supremacist and colonial ways of knowing. Part of this work has involved subverting and rehistoricizing existing knowledge systems by sharing Black ways of knowing and living. Black ways of knowing and living, Red Record, Southern Horrors. This sharing practice, passing on what we know and how we know it and how to read, reread, and unread, reorganizes our knowledge worlds by providing textual and methodological, so verbal, nonverbal, written, unwritten, confirmations of Black life as struggle. Citation then could perhaps be considered one fulcrum of Black studies. In a world that despises Blackness, the bibliography, written or sung or whispered or remembered or dreamt or forgotten, ushers in or initiates or teaches or affirms. This is the praxis of being Black and human as struggle. Mm. The sites with a C and the sites with an S, this cites and cites a genre of humanness that emerged from but is not solely defined by plantocratic logics of dispossession. The work cited, what we tell each other about what we know and how we know, contain how to refuse practices of dehumanization. The work cited untangle systems of oppression and talk about resisting racist violence. The work cited are many and various and divergent and overlapping texts, images and songs and ideas that might not normally be read together. The work cited, all of them, when understood as in conversation with each other, demonstrate an interconnected story that resists oppression. We do not have to agree with all the works in the works cited. We do not have to agree with all the works in the works cited. Mm-hmm. We do not have to like all the works in the works cited. We do not have to trust that the works in the works cited are helping. We do have to trust that the works in the works cited are helping us understand and talk about and theorize how to know the world differently. The praxis then is not about who belongs and who does not belong in the index or the endnotes, but rather how we are collectively working against racial apartheid and different kinds and types of violence. While many Black scholars certainly cite white men, when we read their work closely, we can notice that they are anticipating and a priori moving beyond politically as project by producing intellectual narratives that envision renewed liberatory infrastructures that are stitched together not by specific names, but by the praxis of sharing ideas about how we might and can resist multi-scalar injustices. Audre Lorde, Hortense Spillers, Carol Boyce Davies, Alice Walker, In Search of Our Mother's Gardens, Maya Angelou, Zora Neale Hurston, Barbara Christian, Barbara Smith, Paula Giddens, Norbezi Philip, When and Where I Enter, In Search of Our Mother's Gardens. Thus we might recognize Black Studies not as a citational project of naming and unnaming, but instead as sharing ideas about how to struggle against oppression. This has less to do with white men as embodied knowers and more to do with doing the work of liberation. This is not, to be clear, a refutation of the politics of naming, hashtag say her name, but noticing that naming and citing Black life, hashtag say her name, is so often not an act of identification designation, but instead about sharing a method for understanding and navigating and perhaps undoing the wrongness of the world. Mm-hmm. How do we notice that the named and unnamed can, together, teach us about liberation? How do our questions change if we're not interested in excluding? Makeda Silvera, silenced. The work of citation for Black feminists specifically has always been one of compiling and sharing bibliographies and syllabi and stories and memories that map the long-standing conversations about how we know what we know and how we share practices of livingness, rememory. Recall the headings on page 221 through 378 of But Some of Us Are Brave. The headings read bibliographies, bibliographic essays, doing the work, selected course syllabi, Sonia Sanchez's The Black Woman, the University of Massachusetts, Amherst, Black Studies, Spring, 1975. While I brokenheartedly abandoned feminism many years ago, I did not abandon Black feminist thought. Mm-hmm. What is important about Ahmed's refusal of white male citations for me is that it inadvertently historicizes the citational politics that have always informed Black feminist thought. The groundbreaking work by Black women intellectuals inside and outside the academy provided and continues to provide an outlook wherein doing the work necessitates and has always necessitated what Vevey Clark calls diasporic literacy, the ability to read and comprehend multifarious and overlapping discourses of the Black diaspora from an informed and learned perspective. What Clark so brilliantly shows is that Black intellectual life has always required skilled citational knowledge and practices. Bigger Thomas. We all know Bigger Thomas. If we don't know Bigger Thomas and someone mentions Bigger Thomas and people look around to see if they know, you know who Bigger Thomas, and you look a bit stunned, we go research Bigger Thomas, and we read and reread Native Son, and we read those essays on Native Son, and then we read James Baldwin's Takedown, as well as White Man Listen, Eight Men, Black Boy, after which we may look over a few of those essays on Bigger Thomas and Biggie Smalls. We then ask everyone we know about Bigger Thomas, what they like, what they don't like, what they thought of Wright's portrayal of masculinity, political economy, and racism. He walked home with a mounting feeling of fear. We know who Bigger Thomas is. Gail Jones, Queen Bee, Eva's Man, Work It, we know. walking through the perfume things honeybees loved. I'm suggesting then that many Black citation practices are not about inclusion and exclusion. This approach is wrong-headed because, in my view, it derails what Angela Davis calls the serious theory of Black liberation, and what is clearly stated in But Some of Us Are Brave as doing the work. Black studies engenders, shares, and demands diasporic literacy. Black studies theorizes Black liberation not through categories, identity, but from the perspective of struggle. In this sense, citations are tasked to resist racial and gendered violence through the sharing of ideas. To repeat, this does not mean that names do not matter, but instead that naming is enveloped in the practice of sharing how we live this world and live this world differently. Hashtag say her name is an unfolding method of struggling against racial violence. Hashtag say her name punctuates human being as praxis. These references are not so much about who or who is not relevant to the work we do, but instead how we radically reimagine liberation collectively, playing in the dark. Naming demands we ask about the unnamed and honor the unnameable for liberation. Books and paper scattered about the floor, fragile stockings and underthings, and the startling green and gold negligee, Noah Larson. Once you have approached the mountains of cases in order to mine the books from them, and bring them into the light of day, or rather of night, what memories crowd upon you, Benjamin? She tries her tongue, her silence softly breaks. Sylvia Winter, June Jordan, pattern master, again, 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 pattern master, more pattern master for me. Wretched of the Earth, Song of Solomon, Inventory, Edward Lee Salt, Sister Outsider, the Black fantastic scenes of subjection. Relation. I want to spend the final portion of this story returning to a comment I made earlier. When we are doing our very, very best work, we are acknowledging the shared and collaborative intellectual praxis that makes our research what it is. Here I turn to Edward Lee Sant to figure through how books and sources and footnotes and referencing generate textual narratives that are once opaque and liberatory. As we know, Poetics of Relation begins with the slave ship and the chapter titled The Open Boat. The cramped and suffocating space, the mess of vomit and lice, the weight of death, the vertigo, the dizziness. Whenever a fleet of ships gave chase to the slave ships, it was easiest just to lighten the boat by throwing cargo overboard. My sadness sits around me. Lisant's text is for me brilliant for the way he offers us the non-world as one, although I would argue not the only, one beginning of Blackness. In Poetics of Relation, the middle passage forecloses the normative ties between identity and place, the blood in the land. Filial geographies are unkind and harmful. Filial geographies are unkind. Black geographies are unhinged from territory and its attendant juridical requirements. The middle passage is rupture. The middle passage annihilates land claims. The middle passage is unspeakable. The middle passage is a non-world. The non-world is too awful to pass on, but it does not disappear. The non-world produces a set of restless geographic knowledges that cannot be proved, but can be imagined, conceivable in transport of thought. Suspended, undifferentiated identity, removed, not yet, without names, nowhere at all, unmade, unknown, unclaimed richness of possibility, Hortense Spillers. So Lisant refuses all modes of geographic belonging that are tied to racist and colonial knowledge systems. Lisant shows that one of the most brutal of racial geographies, the Middle Passage, produces conditions of Black refusal. He uproots and discards ancestry. He gives us unconscious fugitive memories. He gives us errantry and relation and opacity. The enslaved, including those lost on the Middle Passage, are tasked to inhabit the world differently. Enslaved and post-slave subjects are tasked to imagine the world differently. Glissant's analytical move is, in my view, profound. The consequences of middle passage rupture, the outcome of annihilation, is a way of knowing and belonging capaciously and generously. The non-world and its inhabitants are not beholden to the taxonomic proof that swirls around them, defines them, objectifies them. We are not beholden to the taxonomic proof that swirls around us. Instead, the non-world engenders the urgent praxis of unwriting racial taxonomies and its attendant spatial violences. This is the referential work, for me, of Black studies. The non-world produces a referential knowledge system that is committed to sharing Black ways of knowing and living. The non-world produces a knowledge system that cannot be proved. The non-world produces a lesson that cannot be contained in the main text. One important key for us to think about, therefore, specifically in the context of this conversation, but I think in any conversation about sort of doing the work of liberation in the academy, so one important thing for us to think about is geography. Colonial and positivist geographies necessitate authentication, and authentication authenticates belonging on colonial and positivist terms. Knowledge systems that value transparency authenticate these geographies. The purveyors of colonial and positivist geographies, those empowered by racial capitalism, authenticate these places by valuing and economizing normative reading practices that require racial subordination. Derek Gregory, white male alert, I still go back to geographic imaginations all the time. Derek Gregory draws attention to the ways the production of space is tied to the materiality of intellectual inquiry. Avery Gordon, in a slightly different way, thinks about the materiality of institutional storytelling. We can thus acknowledge that references and citations are concretized, that colonialism and positivism have referential consequences, that references concretize inequity, and that referencing is a spatial project. Words make place. The notes, footnotes, endnotes are like map legends and cartographic keys that further explain how we read the plot, the cartogram, the borders, the diagrammic data. We can also acknowledge at the same time that citations in Black studies, when cast as doing a work of liberation rather than calculating the names, provide concrete clues about how to live this world differently. The materiality of intellectual inquiry, the ideas we share, the counsel we give each other, is an ongoing referential conversation about Black humanity. The materiality of intellectual inquiry is a conversation that knows and believes in and does not have to be convinced of Black humanity. The materiality of intellectual inquiry, the ideas we share, is a referential conversation that begins from Black humanness. The referential beginning of colonial and plantocratic geographies, driven by a logic of accumulation and dispossession and dehumanization, therefore cannot capture a Black sense of place. Glissant, keenly aware of these constraining and brutal processes, turns geography on its head by refusing the law-like systems that underwrite the production of space. Instead, he argues that the production of space for Black subjects holds in it the possibility of a non-world that unravels in post-slave contexts as a totally different system of geographic knowledge that cannot replicate subordination precisely because it is born of and holds on to the unknowable. He gives us, to return to my earlier point, unknowing as a way of being, and perhaps most importantly, as we wade through the poetics of relation, because that's how you read it, as we wade through the poetics of relation, he shows us that the citational politics are inexhaustible enunciations of ideas that cannot be systemized, yet resonate together. He reads James Joyce beside Bob Marley, beside the architecture of Chicago, beside the shantytown. Glissant gives us everything and nothing all at once. Diasporic literacy emerges from and is our collective knowledge of the open boat. The open boat necessitates Black freedom-inspired purpose as a lesson, and the lesson site with a C and site with an S, how we might live Black outside the taxonomies that swirl around us. Referencing is hard. We share our lessons of unknowing ourselves, and in this we refuse what they want us to be. We risk reading what we cannot bear and what we love too much, and then we let it go, and then we revise and read it again. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The beginning
that's a hard question. How do we make ourselves legible? I think there's a few ways to do that. I come from an interdisciplinary background, what was then called women's studies. The Women in Work program at York University. And I took a feminist geography course with Linda Peake, who became my supervisor. And I tell this story at every talk I give. I did a clandestine degree in Black Studies. You know, I took one course with Ronaldo Walcott, but I read all this other stuff on my own. We don't have Black Studies in Canada. Well, we are only recently getting Black Studies in Canada, because apparently we weren't there. I think that if you're in an interdisciplinary program like AFM or Ethnic Studies or Women and Gender Studies and so on and so forth, I think it's really important to sort of pitch yourself as doing that work as an interdisciplinary discipline. And I think that that's sort of a smart way to sort of position yourself and try not position yourself as someone who can do everything, because that's how they will see you. So if you work in film, for example, you can say my strengths are, you know, Black film, da 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 da, sort of use the sub-disciplines as a way to navigate the job market. Because I've noticed a big opening up in the US and in Canada, I guess in North America, of jobs in Black studies. We know that this is a neoliberal project, right? We know why they want us there, and it's not for liberation. So how do we do that work and then create a space where we can do the work of liberation in the classroom? I mean, one thing that Sylvia Winter said to me is get tenure, right? So there are practical things, right? And she was right. Get tenure and then do what you want, right? Then you can write that long sentence that I did. So I think there is the practical work. Network, get to know your people. Who has book series at Duke in the area that you're studying? Get your senior mentors to tell you who to talk to. Should I take this to Minnesota Press? Should I take it to University of Georgia Press? Do that sort of that nitty-gritty work. And it's complicated, because if you're working in the community or you're a poet and so on and so forth, it can get difficult sort of producing that portfolio. But she was right. I also think that, you know, we are intellectuals and we're in intellectual space, and that's where we have to have these conversations as well. So that's not really, that's sort of a difficult, it's, you know, as someone who has tenure, it's easy for me to say, oh, just get tenure, right? When it's really, really, really hard to do. But I think that if you have your people around you, you can do it. Yeah. So sorry. It's awful. Like I said, marketing, I think I said like the worst words on the planet. That response. Sell yourself. Trick them into thinking you're doing a discipline. I don't know. But I do think mentorship matters, right? And I think that's important. And I do a lot of mentoring work outside my university. It's a lot of work, but I write those letters, I do that work, so reach out.
Questions there?
Hi. So a year ago I asked you a question about particular books, but I won't say which one, but one of the things that you said in response was that there are some problematic citations in that book.
Mm-hmm.
And so
citations because I read it after, but it's probably in mine, in this copy, but around sort of how do we, what kind of work are we doing when we're reading? And what are we doing the work we want to do? And I've noticed this sort of with a panicked, extremely problematic response to how Sylvia Winter is being referenced after that the human being as praxis came out, which is human bracket Winter. And I feel like there's some shorthanding going on with some Black scholars. And so it's really, this isn't specifically about the conversation that we had in the UK, but it is about sort of the broader practices. Like and I think that the panel prior to this talked about this a little bit. We're economizing citations. We're thinking about it in certain ways. We're saying performativity and we're bracketing Butler and then we're moving on. And I don't know if I agree with that. And I think, you know, if we are here, if we are in this space, and if we have a little bit of time to read, then we should do that work a little bit more patiently. But this opposes what you mentioned, where we're in an economy where it's sped up, and you have to finish your PhD in 4 years, and that PhD has to be a book, right? And you have to get that book with the press before you go on the market, and all this other stuff. So it is it's a contradiction. But I do think for sort of scholars with tenure track jobs and senior scholars, they can take that time. I think they can take that time to do that patient reading. And I think that's the best way I can answer that, the quick citations aren't doing the work of liberation. They're not talking about it's not a conversation.
Is it like a kind of cover of being unclear or imprecise or of not being respectful or caring enough?
Yeah, I think it's the latter. Because I wonder, I do wonder with the Black body phenon, how much that misses new humanism. And so what's our role in Black studies to sort of engage phenon in a serious way and really wrap our heads around the radical rethinking of what it means to be human that he's offering us, rather than saying he's talking about a Black body.
Yes.
That's sort of what I'm thinking about. Yeah.
I love you.
I always wish my dad was at these talks. I always bring him up. I'm like, see?
We've got this one on record, though.
They're reading. citations differently as a conversation among people who are interested in liberation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not as an erasure of the Foucault or whatever, right? Like, I've said that, you know, I feel like I've been thinking about this a long time, and I always use the same examples. And it's not erasing Foucault. Instead, it's asking ourselves what Toni Morrison could tell Foucault, that kind of thing, right? Like, so sort of, like, and what Foucault can tell Toni Morrison, but the more interesting question for me is sort of what Toni Morrison can offer us as an intellectual interlocutor of what liberation means. And I think that it's sort of our job, and I think LaToya's presentation sort of thought about this, especially in relation to Clyde's work, but it's sort of our job to allow our citation and our referencing politics to animate those kinds of politics outside of post-Combahee River collective identity politics, right? So, it is about being collective. It is about sharing knowledge. It is about sort of reimagining relationality, in which is always difficult and awful as well. So yeah, I think that yeah. So I think any bibliography can do that. I don't think necropolitics. I don't think citations are necropolitical. I don't think they have to be. It scares me that they might be. So yeah, I feel like if you're doing the workshop, then that's when you introduce ways of knowing. Like, I don't know when the last time anyone in this room reread But Some of Us Are Brave, mm-hmm. but the last half of that book is all bibliographies and course syllabi. And I remember like those are sources of knowledge. What the hell was Sonia Sanchez teaching? Right at that moment, what happens if we teach it within a new context? So it sort of gives us strategies to live the world differently. Many years ago, I got my hands on Winter's course outline when she taught a course here at Berkeley. Of course, it's like 500 pages long, and I wanted to write this like paper on this course outline. It was such a ridiculous kind of. Well, then it was ridiculous, but now I'm like, yeah. Pre-tenure. I can't believe what she does in that book, in that course outline, what she was having them read. And I think that sort of, we have to share that stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's being done. There's the lemonade syllabus. But there's, you know, there are important conversations about how these stories have been told over and over and over again. My point is that Black feminists have been doing this all along. Mm-hmm. Slavery produced Black people as data, and how we can know outside of that. And that's inspired by Cydia Hartman's Venus in Two Acts and the asterisk. I've written a little bit about that. And then I thought about computer algorithms. Mm-hmm. And so I wrote a paper on algorithms, and that will be in the book, that's based on an algorithm that was produced in Chicago to predict the premature death of Black people. So they created an algorithm based on school records, which included attendance, detention, so on and so forth. And then they could pinpoint who would probably die within the next year. Mm. And so So I read this study. It was in Harper's Magazine, and then I wrote this paper on algorithms, and this is it. And then that paper ends with a confession, and the confession is that I'm not a computer scientist, and that I realized sort of the promise of interdisciplinarity of adoring physics but not really knowing anything about it, reproduced physics as a metaphor rather than a deep engagement with it. And I felt like that, my partner is, he's not a computer scientist, but he does computer programming and design and so on and so forth, so he understands the back end. And so I would have these conversations with him like, what's it? Like, you know what I mean? Like, how does it work? You know, and so, but it was sort of the limits of my knowledge. So, and that's why. So it's not a. So the confession was, you know, how do we do sort of radical or rogue interdisciplinary work, but also recognize that we can't be theoretical physicists unless we go back and have time to do a degree in that, right, and the money and so on and so forth. And that was really hard for me to face. So the Dear Science is like almost a letter to science, but it's also bound up in that confession. Does that make sense? It's not a total abandonment, but it's also a questioning of sort of thinking about what we can't intellectually do. But it's not to foreclose people exploring that, I think, but it's just sort of my limits. Yeah. Thank you.
There's no last question.
Oh, there's a question.
Danielle?
I'm going to follow the last question. So, I think I have a question about, as you were reading, I was thinking about all, like, trying to think, like, in this sort of limited way that you can when you're trying to listen, like, how I know the things that I know and some of the most important things that I know. Mm-hmm. And some of the most important things that I know, and I think it's the most important things that a lot of us know, like, didn't come from these texts that we've read, may have come from conversations that we've had with people who have nothing to do with these academies and these spaces. And I've seen Alexis Pauline Gums, who I know engages with your work, like, talk a little bit about, like, what do we do in terms of our citing practice, right? When, like, what we, like, how we know what we know is coming from a space outside. Like, we may read something about the thing that we already knew from outside, right? Mm-hmm. And we may be able to cite that thing, right? But, yeah, how do we engage that in our practice, right? Is there a way to do that? And I ask specifically because I presented about this yesterday. All these people who's, you know, oral histories, right, in Lowndes County, and the things that I learned in that space, and I'm just like, I'm sure, right, that someone has written these things and I have not read them yet, right? But this is where I learned it, right? Like, in this space. And I'm wanting to be serious in my engagement, right, about that, right, as a very early scholar. And I don't know if I can really until I get tenure. And then there's also the question, right, of, like, how do you actually write with? Because there's been one of the community folks that I'm working with who's actually been working with academics for a long time, who's a non-academic. And he has written things with, right, scholars and had his name alongside scholarship and so has been cited. But, like, that always feels like, oh, we talk about it as, like, a community accountability practice, right, rather than as, like, a serious engagement with, like, the body of knowledge that this person possesses or these people possess. So.
I love that question, and I think about it a lot, and I think about sort of what our role as academics are in relation to non-academic knowledge. And I, in my own work, I work a lot with poetry. And one of the ways I've thought about that thought about poetry and sort of narratives where we learn outside the academy is to like really be invested in that as an intellectual engagement.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways to do that, I think, is to not apply the phenon to the narrative, but try and create a conversation between the theory and the alternative knowledge system.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that's hard to do, but I think that that's our job to do that radical interdisciplinary work, is to not to centralize one or the other, but to show that there's a conversation going on about these things. And one of the ways that we can do that, that I've been increasingly turning to more and more in my work, is to decenter the Black body as a central analytical site, and instead, you know, ask questions about, for example, water, or the tree, or do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And that's not displacing the Black body, but it's recognizing how the Black body has become a currency in the academy that's continually produced in as abject, right?
Yes.
And I think it has a citational currency. This goes to your question. It has a citational currency, and so on and so forth. So how do we ask ourselves questions that honor Black embodiment and Black humanity, but do not reproduce the abject, you know, the abject citation? And this goes back to sort of what I was saying about Toni Morrison. You know, if the bluest eye is a theory, and we talked about this a little bit, someone, I've talked about Toni Morrison all week, I think, the last couple days. But if Toni Morrison is a theory, or if the bluest eye is a theory and a theorist, or offers us a theoretical avenue to thinking about X or Y,
mm-hmm.
that's more, you know, so if those what you know outside is a theoretical tool, what happens?
Right.
And that to me is exciting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah.
Catherine, I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
It follows from this, I think. I've been curious about what your conversation with Sylvia Winter has enabled,
mm-hmm.
and how it's shifted your thought, and particularly, you know, I guess I, you know, been having some of these conversations here, but on the margins, but. I have this kind of a sort of fear around the ontological term that often the shift from the human happens at the same time as, you know, we're all here in the academy, and there's the Fanny Lou Hamer Center, which is, you know, created from struggle. So there's an important, you know, there's spaces, fragile spaces that have opened up for people of color, queer people, Black people in the academy, very fragile,
mm-hmm.
and at the same time, there's this shift away from human,
mm-hmm.
you know, post-humanism,
right.
animal turn,
oh,
object-oriented
yeah.
ontology, all this stuff. So I'm wondering what, you know,
mm-hmm.
and thinking with Sylvia Winter's own trajectory, which there's some parallels with yours,
mm-hmm.
but like, you know, and her ontological turn, read through Fanon, through
mm-hmm.
Black radical tradition, through Black feminist thought,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
literature,
mm-hmm.
so many parallels. And then, you know, what does that ontological turn do, and, you know, in relation to these other
mm-hmm.
kinds of ontological turns?
So, yeah, and I guess Camilla and I talked about this in one way at lunch, but I think that, I don't know, I think that we just need to do the work.
Mm-hmm.
And so if post-humanism or Afrofuturism gets you there, you do that, right? But I think I do believe it, and I think that one of the things that Winter has offered me is to centralize the human and genres of human, and sort of that's my anchoring, you know what I mean? That's my anchoring thing. So post-humanism and the Anthropocene don't really interest me a lot,
mm-hmm.
unless it's that Gilroy talk, you know, at IBG or whatever. So it's like, though, you know, and I think that's a huge privilege that we have in the academy is, you know, in it, like I said, we read what we read and we read what we don't like to read, and then what if we don't like to read it? We don't have to go back and keep reading. You know what I mean? We have, like, we can do, you know what I mean? Like, we can sort, so if you don't like the post-human, you don't have to, you know, we can do something else. And that's, you know, I think that it's that's also about generosity. It's not about, like, I hate the post-humanists, get them out of my hair, right? It isn't really. It's like, this isn't doing the liberation project that I want to do, so I got to do something else. I got to figure out a different question. I got to figure out a different framework. That's the one thing that Winter has offered me, is sort of that, and she's so generous. Like, I mean, just like the bigness of her, of the way, you know, anyway. But just, it's to read carefully and closely and that kind of thing, rather than focus on those other debates. Does that make sense? Yeah, and I have to say that I have other Ruthie, you know, there's lots of people, I think, in the academy who think that way, and I think that we have to really cherish that and honor it. Yeah.
Catherine, on that note, we have to thank you and for your generosity. Please don't go anywhere. We have a special sort of treat in a way. The last, we have one more event, and Catherine, I might. But you can also actually.
No, I don't have
We have Chandra Bimal, who's been taking notes throughout this conference, and it's a real privilege to introduce Chandra. So Chandra is an associate professor of African American Studies and Anthropology at Colby College. I know her from back in the day when we were both at this incredibly creative moment at the University of Michigan, where the boundaries between anthropology and history had been broken down in this program called Anthrohistory. Chandra's first book is an edited collection that really archives that experiment in interdisciplinarity. And Chandra was, I think, the person in that Anthrohistory project who was bringing the insights of a black radical imagination into Anthrohistory. So it's particularly important and wonderful work, which is also connects to a lot of the questions that we've been wrestling with around archives and spatialization of thinking across space and time. Chandra's work is on a line from the Catherine McKittrick bag, a phrase, blackness is flying. Mm-hmm. And that's, Chandra's work has been about taking the Black Atlantic into aviation, thinking about the intersections of Black Atlantic history of the British Empire across the triangular trade and British Airways and her book is coming out later this year, so we all have to, you know, read it when it comes. It's coming out from NYU Press, called Empire in the Air, again, Black Atlantic, aviation, British Empire, key themes, decolonization, diaspora, air travel, race and empire. So Chandra is being incredibly generous by not speaking about herself, which is what we do all the time as academics, but really about speaking about, you know, how she has engaged all the amazing insights of this conference. So thank you for that generosity,
Chandra. Thank you for inviting me. I was hoping you'd be the main part of yourself. You know,
that was
yours. Be Catherine. No, I can't. Can I follow, really?
Well, you don't want to be.
Amazing keynote that I'm not. But I will say a few points that I think reverberate with what you were talking about. So I'd like to begin by giving thanks to the organizers. And I'm acutely aware of the fact that there are these 15 minutes between us and a reception.
Yes.
So I've been given the awesome task of offering closing remarks. And I have to say that closing remarks feels really wrong to me. For me, the symposium, and perhaps Black geographies as a whole, has been breath-giving rather than breathtaking. So I want to honor this breath-givingness by offering a few opening remarks.
And my hope is to locate the threads that have been wandering through the sessions. And I have to say, much of what I've prepared has been prepared on the fly, so to speak, with you while you've been presenting. So all of my thoughts are very unpolished and unformed and rough and fragmented and disconnected to your connections. And I find that incredibly liberating, so thank you. Thank you for that. So here's how I'm going to do this. First, I'm going to identify some threads. And I'm thinking about threads less as strands and more like drifts, as in gists, in keeping with the theme of black drifts from session one. And then I'm going to say something about the grapplings of each session. And then I'm going to offer some really great questions for us to think with, though I have to say maybe they don't have particular answers. So, some threads. I'm going to call the first thread willingness. So, across these sessions, and I think even in the design of the symposium itself, there is willingness. And it's a willingness to struggle with and to struggle against the widening and deepening impulse to separate so as to segregate intellectual and activist work. And it seems that because of this willingness, some of us are moving closer to a version of intellectual and activist play, a work that actually allows for some serious play. And I think one of the best examples of this actually are the opening remarks that began yesterday, and they began unapologetically with the personal experiential, which is that they didn't necessarily start with the personal, but with the experience of the personal, right? So it was about them and not about them all at the same time. And that's a willingness. The second thread that I think has run through both days is, I'm going to call it concern. And it's two entangled realms of a very particular concern. So some folks have talked about a concern about the about knowledge production. And then other folks have been concerned with the production of knowledge. And I really, at the end of today, am thinking about whether or not they are one and the same. And at times, especially yesterday, I found myself wondering if this switch around of words, right, so knowledge production versus the production of knowledge, is in some kind of way a reframing of the material and the symbolic debate that we know all so well. So thinking through that brings me to the third thread, which I'm going to call frame. And I've been very much taken with this phrase of black geographies at framework. And at the end of day one, it really seemed to me that black geographies, as we've been encountering it, actually is less about framework in a conventional sense of context or a set of ideas, and perhaps more about black geographies as a kind of frameworking, which is to say black geographies as process, which of course takes us back to the second thread of production and knowledge. And the fourth thread is, and I'm calling it for now, gape, although I think it could also be called rift, as in the rift in drift. And gape, I want to say, is more in the noun sense here, as in an opening, and a particularly wide opening, a breach or a breaching, and it's a breaking. So I've seen and heard and felt this gape in our overwhelming concern about silences, erasures, gaps, the not there, the incomplete, the absence, the fissures, and really talking through each and every session, talk through and thinking about the archive. And you're going to hear me talk about the archive throughout sort of my wrap up of the different sessions. So I'm going to talk about the sessions now. And each of these sessions I really felt sort of set us up in good ways. And they set us up to grapple with particular themes. And of course, I can't capture them all, so I'm going to pull out particular ones and just highlight them. So I think session one really set us up to grapple with possibility. As someone put it, the what and the when ifs, and the what and the whens that could be. Right? So possibility. And it also set us up to grapple with potential. Right? The potential of what Robin Kelly and others have called a political education. it set us up to grapple with our capacity to feel Black geographies. And it set us up to grapple with this notion of drift, of movement, and a particular kind of movement that's about decentering, or perhaps obliterating centers altogether. Session two set us up to grapple with this phrase that came up in this session and others, which is the no one knows. And it's a really curious phrase. And I think it's really quite fitting for a session that was about, well, the planetary, right? The knowing what's out there. So I started thinking about the no one knows. And uncovering was the other word that was used in relationship to the no one knows. And I have to ask, really, who exactly is that no one that we keep saying doesn't know? And because what became very clear to me by the end of today is that historical actors, ancestors, they know. And it's important to recognize the fact that they think they know. And I wonder if that phrase that the no one knows actually pushes back against this idea of ancestors and historical actors knowing. And a lot of that thinking is influenced by Trio and his understanding of the archive, right? This notion of really troubling the not there. Like, what is it we're actually saying with the not there? So in that, I've been thinking about the word incomplete, which came up in session two, and wondering really if archives are actually incomplete, or if they're incomplete, which is to say that the missing is there as the present in the complete, right? It's disruptive always. So archives love to present themselves as complete, especially nationalist-oriented archives, right? And they're so jam-packed full of silences that we know, but those silences are embedded in the notion of the complete itself. Again, Trio has lots to say about that and silencing the past. So in this session, we also were set up to ask a lot of questions about sources and our source material. And in doing so, I think this session really set us up to grapple with a very particular kind of question about archives, which is how, if at all, can Black geographies create new archives? How can Black geographies not only create new sources, but actually, in fact, be new ways to do the sourcing? I have to say, because I'm all about skies and outer space, that I did wonder with this particular panel on the planet if it was possible for us to get quantum and go galactic. And so I was thinking a lot about Sun Ra and George Clinton and others, you know, the whole space is the place. And I think it's really interesting to think about that kind of work in relationship to the last session, which talks about maroonage. And here, of course, it's about flight. Black people have been flying for a really long time, centuries. And I think it's really interesting to think about the notion of maroonage and that version of flight in relationship to space is the place, and thinking about, well, the occupation of other planets. So along those lines, and thinking about the question that came up in session three about the state, and whether or not we're talking about state formation as this state or other states, I want to say that perhaps this Black planet that we were asked to think about, actually maybe it's not this planet, right, the fear of another one, the one that is out there, that the no one doesn't know but wants to know about. And I think really bringing into conversation outer space is really important, especially as suborbital travel actually becomes more and more possible, and who has access to that kind of moving around the Earth. So Moscow to London becomes 1 to 2 hours instead of the tremendous amount of hours that it is now. So that's session two, thinking about this planet. Session three. I think session three really set us up to grapple with this notion of frame. And they talked a lot about frames of houses and rooms and also frames of knowledge. And it was in this session that I really started to think about the fact that we do a lot of making in Black geographies. So Black geographers in the Black geographies world are knowledge makers, and I think we make archives is a really interesting idea that came out of session three that perhaps we can talk about tomorrow. And in doing so, part part of what happened in session three was that we were really asked to question our reliance on the visual. So session three really sets us up to grapple with the notion of what I like to think about as sensing, the feeling. In particular, I do a lot of my work in archives. And the experience when you're in the archive and you get that feeling that there's something there, but it's something not there at the same time. It's quick and it's fleeting and you can't even see it, but you can feel it. And that's a sensing. And I wonder if Black geographies can't think through this notion of sensing a bit more, perhaps even in relationship to methodology. This session, session three, sets us up to grapple with the notion of the in-between and imagination. And we spent a lot of time, especially in the Q&A piece, talking about, what constitutes the in-between. And I want to say, bringing session three into conversation with session five, that it's particularly interesting to think about dreamscapes and imaginations as sites to do field work. That's sort of what session five gave me. And if we think about dreamscapes and imagination as actual sites that we can do participatory observation, perhaps, right, that kind of field work, then it might actually overhaul the notion of the in-between that's existing in one realm, right, on one plane. People who are moving and are stuck, so they're not, they're betwixt and between arrival and, or points of departure and points of arrival, right? So they're not in between, they're just in a dreamscape or they're in imagination. Session four, and this is I got time to sleep with those sessions. This is from today, so this is a bit more disoriented, please bear with me. So session four really sets us up to grapple with intervention, invention, and once again, imagination. And this session is all about layers and pollution and dust and the messy, which I want to hold on to that for a little bit. We went into the swamp. And the first thing I thought about was this notion of dust. And archives, as you know, are very dusty places. So what is the relationship between dust, right, of physical redevelopment, and the dust of archive, keeping in mind that Black geography might be about creating archives, right? Do archives, in fact, pollute? And if so, what are they polluting? The other thing that this session really sets us up to think about is the importance, and I just absolutely love this, the importance of mess. And possible, like the possibility for messy narratives. Perhaps we need messy narratives, porous narratives, swampy narratives, right? Narratives that books that are totally open, and I think we heard a lot about that in the keynote session. Just this writing narratives, sentences that just are pry open rather than shut down and create sort of passageways to ownership. Right? So again, we make our. And I think the Butler quote that came up, the write yourself in, is particularly important there in this question of, like, what the heck is a messy narrative? Why do narratives have to be so neat? The other thing that started to happen, though, at the very end of session four, is I started to actually question the openness itself. Like, what are the politics of this openness that I hold on to at all points in time and offering it up right now? Because what happened at the end of session four is we were asked to confront the notion of the cracked door in Bible study, right, and who that lets in. And that led me to question, really, who has access to openness? And within that, I just raised the question too, which really comes through in session five, which is we need, perhaps, different ways to read, right, to gain access to the doors, different ways to read scholarship and journals, right? We need to read messy. So session five takes us back to the swamp came up again, and it takes us back to this notion of a swampy knowledge and a swampy archive, but it's a totally different way because this session is about liberation. So with this session did was to, for me, was to raise some questions about duty and obligation. Those were two words that came up during the session. And I started to think about duty and obligation in relationship to liberation and knowledge-making practices. And really to ask the question, like, what is our duty, right? And what is our obligation, particularly within Black geographies? And perhaps, since what I'm about to say comes out of the papers themselves, perhaps one of our duties is to keep in mind that the thinking is the doing always, right? And perhaps another piece is to continue to open up these spaces in our narrative. And in session 5, they talk specifically about opening up in ways that are about being willful and defiant and, in fact, allowing for people to breathe. Session 5 also drew our attention to openness in relationship to keep the material, right? So who gets to be funded? What gets to be read, which again is about the review process and scholarship and journals. The other piece of session 5 that I think is particularly powerful is the notion of being authorized, getting permission, and where we seek it. And I think that out of that, in terms of liberation, and we heard all of this in the keynote, is really keeping in mind what we teach, what's on our syllabi. And talk about documentation, remembering, again, perhaps we are creating archives always. Which talks we go to also came out of session 5. I'm thinking about possibilities for liberation. The other thing that came out of, or understanding that came out of session 5 is this phrase, and it's not unique to session 5 at all, which is conditions of possibility. And I've been thinking a lot about it. And at first, there's something deeply troubling about the notion of bringing together condition and possibility for me. And I think what I've come to understand is conditions of possibility seems to mean here, again, a kind of, well, spaciousness, a kind of openness, a kind of willingness, as opposed to how I originally thought about it, which is the conditioning of possibility, which sort of troubles me in very great ways. Right? So resisting the conditioning of possibility, but perhaps in liberation, really thinking about the conditions of possibility. And doing that in order, and then I'll come to the end of talking about the sessions, thinking about readiness is where session 5 sort of came to an end, and thinking about what comes to us when we are ready. And this we here, in fact, may not be a we that actually exists, so it may not be the I, but it might in fact be a we that is about 100 years out, who knows. And I think about that readiness in relationship to Suzanne Césaire's famous phrase about the permanent readiness for the marvelous, and the ways in which Black geographies perhaps can help us really think about what that would look like, or even more importantly, feel like today, right, for a future kind of need. Also, let us never forget, session 5 says we must, for liberation, ask radical questions. Which brings me to some, I don't know if they're radical or not, but some questions, some big ones for us to think with. So the first big, big question that I have, and it came to me yesterday as the sessions went on, is why discipline? So what struck me after lunch in particular was the ways in which we present ourselves and the ways in which we all claim our disciplines, or even the interdiscipline is a kind of bizarre discipline. And I started to, and I was talking to Sharad about this, what would happen if we never did that in Black geographies? Like, what kind of possible conversations can happen if we actually don't claim a kind of expertise or training? Of course, we have it. But I just offered up that there might, in fact, be, I don't know, new constellations of knowledge that can happen if we don't claim a particular identity. It would be strange. But one of the things that gave me such delight was reading the bios that were prepared for this symposium, because some of them are so outside the normal script, and it's wonderful and delightful, and thinking about the different ways we can present ourselves in an academic arena. So my first big question is, what's Black geographies going to do with disciplines? The next question I have is about weight. And I really want to think with people about the weight of Black geographies. So if Black geography is a kind of frameworking that allows us to hold in a single narrative frame. Joy and love and fire and flesh and pain and abstraction and liberating dreaming and nightmares and so on. What is the mass of the matter that we've been talking about, right? What is its gravitational pull, if there is one at all, right? What is the weight? And I don't here mean weight in terms of significance. I actually mean weight in terms of the importance of lightness and the importance of perhaps heaviness, and maybe there's some other kind of ness that Black geographies can help us think through. The third question, and second to last question, is about pace. And this question is, what is the pace of Black geographies? And I've been thinking a lot about the beauty of collaborative work, and that has come up across all of the sessions in different language, but it's there. And thinking about what collaborative work actually can look like and feel like and be like nowadays. And I wonder about the different paces that exist. In particular, thinking about pre-tenure and post-tenure people, which operate, I think, perhaps at different paces, which is, of course, about power, right, and force. How do we think about that, right? What are the different speeds that are operating in Black geographies, and how can we pay attention and perhaps disrupt or recognize that there are different paces that are at work? So, the fourth question is about the phrase that's in the title, insurgent knowledge, which the word insurgent hasn't actually come up a lot. But it's interesting because the word insurgent, right, of course, has in it in surge, right, if we just separate them out a little bit. And I wanted to think about the possibilities of Black geographies as really opening the way to either occupy or be in the surge, right? Can we operate with and through force, right? And what does that mean, to be in the surge? And of course, knowledge and thinking whether or not we should perhaps occupy the ledges of knowing, right? So flipping the knowledge around a bit and sticking with space. And by that I mean risk, right? What are the risks we are willing to take and imagine for ourselves in creating new narratives, right, in archives, etc. So, I'm going to conclude there. I think I might have brought us a little over our 15. I apologize for that. But hopefully, these many different threads help us to carry on the conversation tomorrow. And I want to thank you all again for just an incredible, breathtaking 2 days. So thank you.
I just want to say, I thought it was so fitting. Kylie started us yesterday asking us to stop and breathe and consider the space and why we were here, and you asked us once again to breathe. So, you know, there's a beautiful symmetry to these 2 days.
Yeah, and thank you again for making this such a lively space and for coming in with all of your questions and your attentiveness. And this is, as Chandra was saying, this is really only the beginning. You know, it's an opening to much deeper and more lively engagements with Black geographies. So we invite you to, you know, be in touch with us. We're BerkeleyBlackGeography@gmail.com. Seriously, continue the discussion with any ideas that you have. And for now, we have a reception where we can continue to mingle and party. It's going to be at McCone Hall, which is the geography department here at Berkeley. I think I can lead a group of us over there. It's for maybe Jake.
Thank you so much.
I'm sorry. And just a couple other announcements. So getting to the phone, if any folks have limited mobility, please let me know. I have a car. I can take 4 people over there. Just a reminder, echoing what LaToya said yesterday, please consider participating in the Black Geographies theme sessions at the AAG in 2018. And last but not least, if you're interested in really kind of, you know, taking taking on this, you know, the good vibrations. We've talked about vibrations and embodiment and embodied knowledges and sonic geographies into the evening. One of our colleague comrades in geography has been organizing a night of dance and performance in Oakland. The information is actually on the very back of your program, and also there's more information posted to the Facebook event page. So we also invite you to that. Thank you all so much.
And it's the fifth floor.
Can we please also take our trash with us outside? Many receptacles for it. Thank you. Even if it's not your trash, please, we help each other inside.
In the direction of the
All right. Sure.
Yeah, we're going to go.